Welcome, everyone. It's so good to see all of you. We've come to worship the Lord, to celebrate Him. Let me read to you some scripture. Our call to worship, this one is in Revelations. Revelations chapter 15, and beginning with verse 3. It says, "And they sang Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb. Great and marvelous are your deeds, Lord God Almighty. Just and true are your ways, King of the ages. Who will not fear you, O Lord, and bring glory to your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship before you, for your righteousness and your acts have been revealed." We want the presence of God this morning to reveal Himself to us and speak to our hearts. Let's pray as we enter into our worship. Father God, thank you for the opportunity to worship together. For you are great and worthy of our praise. And we invite you into this place this morning. Come, Lord, be glorified and lifted up in our worship. And Lord, speak to our hearts. We need to hear from you. Reveal yourself to us, we pray this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. We invite you to stand. Let's worship together.
Thank you. We have been doing, you guys have been doing Trunk or Treat for a while, and we've moved it this year to be on the Saturday, hoping that we'd get more kids involved. We have been putting out signs. The banner that we have had for the past few years was hung up today, but if you drive around our neighborhood, there's yard signs that we had made, and we are looking for a great time. We have invited our two local schools to our event and hope that we can outreach to our community more. We are still looking for candy donations. If you have any of those, you can drop them off during the week. And we still have our sign up for the cars. We have about 11 cars right now. We'd like a couple more. Like I said, we have been inviting our community to this event. So we are hoping that we have a great turnout. There's 3 yard signs. There's 1 in front of the Brown Parsonage. There's 2 in front of our church. And if you drive down into the back where the local fire station is, they graciously let us put one into their yard. So there's been a lot of publicity for us. We've had flyers sent to a couple of schools. So we're looking for, it's gonna be a fun time. We have about 4 or 5 games. We have a craft and we have some treats for the kids as well. So we're just looking for a way to outreach to our community a little bit more this time. And we're hoping that you guys can come and support us in that. Oh, sign up's in the back, and there's a pink basket for all the candy. Thank you.
All right. You definitely want to get involved with that, whether it's bringing candy or we still, as Sarah said, we still need a few more cars. It's a fun time and a great way to meet the neighbors around the church and see the children. So come. If you've never done it before, you know, give it a try. And last year was actually my first time. We had a great time with it. And so come on out. And if you're not unsure about what to do with your cars in the trunk type thing, Sarah can explain all that to you. And anybody that's been involved, Jim and Beth or Karen or anybody can explain what to do. So be a part of that. It's a great outreach. Well, we want to give to the Lord in worship this morning, celebrating Him and offering our gifts to Him. We'll ask our ushers to come forward and let's pray for our offering this morning. Father God, thank you for the opportunity to give. This is part of our worship, Lord, to offer these gifts to you. You have blessed, you have touched our lives. And Lord, we want to acknowledge that and give you praise. Bless those who give this morning, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We won't be quiet. God of covenant and faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you'll do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. God, from age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Yeah, your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Oh, great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground.
As if you should do things. wasn't that a great weekend? Would you stand for the doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Downstairs, and you may be seated. Okay. Well, we've been on the journey together, discovering God's grace. And although this is the last sermon in this series, the journey of grace should continue throughout all of our lives. And we invite you again to come out tonight at 6 for the final discussion group together. But on the topic of grace so far, and it'll be up on, there we go. We've come to recognize that grace, right, is a journey that lasts our entire life, whole time, right? That God is working in our lives. This journey is an invitation, right, to get close to Jesus, to walk with him, to grow and be transformed and be commissioned to serve with him in this world. That's all a part of this journey of grace. We have also seen that grace goes before us, making a way for us to God, right? To reach out to us. That's what grace does and brings us to God. We've talked about the fact that the saving grace of God holistically changes our lives, that it isn't just about our spiritual condition, although that is a big part of it. God works in all areas of our lives by his grace and touches us. We talked further about the fact of sanctifying grace, that God comes and cleanses us and empowers us to live Christ-like lives and to go into the world and share his message. The sanctifying grace at work in our lives. And even with our best efforts, we cannot live a holy life without the grace of God, right? He's a part of it. Then we also talked about sustaining grace, the grace that keeps us moving forward and keeps us growing on the path we've been called to, recognizing that our life of faith isn't a sprint, it's a marathon, right? It's a journey. And God's sustaining grace helps us, enables us. And we understood that grace is optimistic and gives us much to celebrate together. It's a gift from God. It's favor towards us from God. And that gift changes everything in our lives. God's grace is an incredible part of the Christian life. But how many of you this morning know that we live in a fallen world? And because it is a fallen world, at times it is a very difficult world to live in. Many Christians who fill our churches, and most likely all of us, have experienced heartache and heartbreak and brokenness and anguish at levels that don't easily go away. They linger, don't they? It lasts. And struggles and suffering are not trivial. And Christians are not exempt from it either. So how do we talk about grace in the middle of that? In the middle of that. In the middle of those times. It's there in those dark times that we experience what we call sufficient grace. Sufficient grace. That's grace to meet us there amid the unresolved, the heavy burdens, the dark places, the grief of our lives. Sufficient grace means enough grace. Enough to take care of the situation. God supplies us with as much grace as we need for every situation we face. As much as we need for every situation we face. This morning we're in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul is struggling. And we begin to verse 6 this morning. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth, but I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears in me. So to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Right. Paul here in 2 Corinthians begs God for the removal of what he calls a thorn in his flesh. But we're not told what exactly that thorn is, but whatever it is, Paul is really struggling with it. What happens then is Paul discovers a different kind of grace here. A grace that isn't a get rid of every bad situation, but instead a grace that is found that gives Paul everything he needs to go through it. Everything he needs to walk through it. A grace that is sufficient, the Lord says. Now, I want you to notice something here with me from Paul, and that is, first of all, a sufficient grace is a gift from God needed by everyone. Sometimes when I'm talking with individuals and they're going through something severe, they kind of think, oh, what did I do to deserve this, right? You didn't do anything to deserve it. We all are in need of the sufficient grace of God. Most people view Paul as this super Christian, right? He did amazing things for the early church. Blazed trails where there was no one else could go. And in 2 Corinthians 12:6, Paul even acknowledges his accomplishments. He says, though I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. There's a talented guy. He's saying, I have every reason, right, to boast. He says, I'm not going to. But it would be the truth, right? So here's a Christian at the top of his game. Paul had an amazing close relationship with God, yet in the middle of all that, Paul tells us his life is plagued with a big struggle. He is struggling. He's in agony. He's tortured, the scripture says. And too often when people are going through a dark time in their lives, they think, well, God must be angry with me. No, he's not angry with you. Struggles come. Right? Or God doesn't care for me. Oh, he cares. Church, everyone has struggles. And that is why everyone needs God's sufficient grace. Put it this way. If I'm standing in the middle of a raging river, I'm going to struggle, right? That's kind of what we are doing in the middle of this world, right? There's a raging river going on. We're gonna struggle. And here's something else. In case you weren't sure, right? And if you're not of the the kind of the science people, you can check this out with my brother-in-law, right? He's a chemist. If you're in the middle of a raging river, you're gonna get wet. Right? You're gonna get wet. Why is it that when we are struggling in the middle of this dark world, we say, God, I don't understand what's going on? When you're in the middle of the river, you're gonna get wet. Right? Jesus said, in the world you will have trouble. Now, if we stopped it there, it would be kind of a depressing sermon. But he says, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. I have sufficient grace for you. Right? 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12 says, dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you as though something strange were happening. Don't be surprised. You're getting wet, right? You're in the middle of the river. A hard time is not an indication that God has left you or is punishing you. It's also not a lack of faith. Here's Paul, super Christian, who's struggling, right? It happens in our lives. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7 says, but we have this treasure in jars of clay, right? To show that the all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. If you want the contemporary English version of that, it says, we have the presence of God in these cracked pots. Did you know you're a cracked pot? There you go. You can go this week and say, you know what my pastor said about me? I'm a crackpot, right? But we are. And we have the all-surpassing power of God within us to show that it's not us, right? What's that mean? That means through the cracks, God's power is being seen, right? Through our weakness. Well, secondly, sufficient grace does not remove problem. It carries us through the problem. It carries us through. Too often, Christians pray once, look for the problem to be taken away, and then when it's not, think that God has failed them. Paul must have been kind of thinking that a little bit. God, I could do so much if you just remove this struggle. Oh, I could be a much better Christian, God. God, I could do so much for you if you just take this away. But God's answer, my grace is sufficient for you. God says, I got this. And we're going to go right through the middle. We're going to go right through the middle, right? You all know that I'm a New England sports fan, you know, with the Red Sox, although lately, you know, we kind of say that with our heads down. or the Patriots, right, who are playing. And when the Patriots are playing and they give the ball to the running back and the running back goes right up through the middle, right? And I'm sitting on the couch thinking, why in the world would you go up the middle through all the people, right? Now, they haven't consulted me, but, you know. Why would you do that? Because they see a way, right? In fact, the announcers call it, oh, look at that lane that they're going through, right? They see a way. God is saying to you this morning, you've got a trouble in your life? My grace is sufficient for you. Here's the way. We're going right up the middle. We're going right through it. I'm going to sustain you. I'm going to help you. Grace is found and discovered amid the fragile cracked jars and persistent thorns. God's grace holds us true. Isaiah chapter 43 But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear, for I've redeemed you. I have summoned you by name, and you are mine. What an amazing thing. God is looking at you this morning and saying, you're mine. I got you. Right? He goes on, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze, for I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. God says, I got this. My grace is sufficient for you. The God who created the world is carrying us. His sufficient grace. Number three, sufficient grace is a part of God working in us to transform us. We've already talked about the fact that God's grace is working in our lives to bring us back to Him and to restore the image of Christ in us. But many times Christians have the wrong concept of sufficient grace. People think, well, prevenient grace and salvation grace and sanctifying grace and even sustaining grace, all are working to transform me. But sufficient grace, that's kind of an emergency act of God to remove the bad. But that's not the case. That's not the case. Sufficient grace is also God working to transform our lives. Remember what God told Paul. He said, my grace is sufficient for you. It's enough, for my power is made perfect when everything's going well. No. My power is made perfect as soon as I take the problem away. No. My power is made perfect in your weakness. When you feel like you can't go on. When the mountain in front of you is too great. God says, my grace is sufficient for you. All right. And I can probably say with certainty that there's no one here today that is hoping, hey, God, how about bringing me some pain, right? And problems into my life. Or, God, I just want to stay in this struggle. Wow. Why am I saying that? It's okay to ask God to remove it. And sometimes He does. But other times, God is working through it in our lives. Right? Struggles, pain produce growth. Right? God does not bring the struggles and the pain, but He works in them to mold us and shape us. For years, I've been on a diet. That wasn't funny. For years, I've been on a diet. And the only thing missing is I'm on this diet that says no struggle, no sacrifice. And that part of my diet's going very well. You see, if we're going to grow, if our lives are going to be improved, it takes struggle. It takes sacrifice. Right? And you could do that, you know, my niece Lauren works out every day and weightlifts and, you know. So if I need something moved in the parsonage, I just call her up. And right? It was unbelievable. You see, the other day, my car got stuck on this rock. We were out in the country. Actually, we were out at a camp meeting, and I went over this rock in my car. If you know anything about it, it's extremely low and small. And so I was just kind of on that rock, and the wheels were... So I asked my brother-in-law, Jim, and Lauren to come over, and they went to the front of the car, and they went, "Oof!" Right? Wow! And I got off the rock. Do you know why they could do that? Because they had been working and painstrugglingly building their muscles, right? The same thing is true in our Christian lives. You want to be a stronger Christian? You've got to go through the trial. You've got to go walk with God and allow Him to work in your life. To work. Number four, sufficient grace is the best solution. Better than our solutions. Better than our solutions. Go back to verse 8. Paul pleaded with God to solve the situation by simply removing the thorn from his flesh. He prayed that God would simply take it from him so that he could move on to bigger and better things. God's answer was different than Paul's answer. Don't be afraid of God's answer. It will be different many times. But don't be afraid of it, because it will be the best for you. He says, "My grace is sufficient for you, for I'm working. My power is at work in you." Right? God's solutions are better than our solutions. God looks out for us by understanding that sometimes it's the best interest not to spare us from things. That doesn't make God a mean God. Those of you who are parents, think about it. There are times, right, when you had to have your children go through things, right? I remember when Christopher, I think it was Christopher, you know, the years just go flying by, you know. One of my sons, no, had breathing problems and had to be taken to the hospital. And at the hospital, they did some breathing treatments, and of course, they poked and prodded, right? And I remember one moment when he was looking up at me like, "Dad, why are you making me go through this?" But without it, he would have died. You see, there are times when God says, "No, you've got to walk through this. It's for your good. And I'll walk with you," he says. Right? When you're faced with problems, there are kind of three ways that we respond. First of all, we do what Paul does and go to God and say, "God, please remove this." Right? Or secondly, we say, "Oh, it's no big deal. I'll handle it on my own." Famous last words, right? Or we say, we stick our head in the sand and hope that it will just go away, right? But you know the thing with all of those? They're our idea. They're our efforts, right? And again, I'm not saying don't ask God to remove it. And that's the first thing I do when I'm in trouble. God, remove it. But the problem comes when God decides other than my idea. Then I get mad, right? Can't believe, God, you didn't remove this. I gave you the plan, right? It's kind of like me and the football team. Guys, I can't believe you're going up the middle, right? If you'd only consulted me, right? Sometimes I think that's what we say to God. "God, if you just consulted me, I would have told you, take it away." And isn't that we can't ask for that? It's the other end side of that, which is we must trust God. He has the best. has the best. The problem is, if we try to handle it on our own, here's what's going to happen. We're going to become focused solely on the problem, right? And it's kind of like putting a magnifying glass over the problem. It gets bigger the more we think about it and look at it. It grows. You see, our problem begins to then overwhelm us and we sink. Thank you, Marcos, for giving me a picture of yourself. We sink because all we can see is the problem, not the God who says, my grace is sufficient, right? The focus on God. Now, I'm not saying that going through it, there won't be times of pain. There won't be times of discomfort, right? But you know what? God is working in you. And he's leading you right up the middle and through. God's grace is sufficient for you, right? God's grace will carry you through. Now, you may say, well, even when I say, okay, God, your plan, I don't feel like, you know, Superman, right? Do you know why that is? Because God gives sufficient grace the way that he gave manna in the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, the children of Israel, right, went up out of Egypt into the desert, and the first thing they did was use up all their provisions. And then they started crying out to God, we don't have anything, God. So God provided manna, right? It's kind of like a bread. And it would arrive every morning, kind of like the dew on the grass, right? There would just be covered with manna, and they would pick it up, and hey, we have our food, right? But you know what? God only supplied enough for the day. Enough for the day. God, what do you mean? Because he came back tomorrow and did it again. Right? Why would God do that? Because he wants a close relationship with us. He wants us to come to him daily. He wants us to be dependent upon him. In fact, when God even warns that when they tried to grab up a bunch of extra manna and save it, right? Kind of their idea. It went bad. It molded. Overnight. Boom, gone. It's gone. It's useless. What was God saying there? Not your way, my way. Right? My way. Someone asked the team to come back up. And so what is happening in your life today? Maybe you are in the middle of a great struggle and the bread from yesterday is gone. The manna is gone from yesterday. God has fresh, sufficient grace for you. You may be thinking, but I don't see the answer. The end to this. Remember the definition of grace. Sufficient means enough to meet the need, enough to take care of it. Don't worry. You can't see down the road, God can. And he's giving you the sufficient grace, step by step, day by day. We're going to close this morning by singing and opening up the altar for a time of prayer. You may say, oh, but if I go down the altar, people are going to know I'm struggling. Welcome to the club. We're all struggling and in need of the grace of God. Come receive his sufficient grace for you. I'm going to invite you to stand as the altar's open as we sing together. If you need new grace this morning, God can offer it. God is waiting to give it to you. We thank you this morning. Your grace is sufficient. Thank you for carrying us. Thank you for working in our lives, oh God. And Lord, right now, you know every situation, every person in this room. So I pray for those who are going through the deep, dark valley right now. God, would you rest upon them with your presence, your power? Would your sustaining grace carry them through? God, in the days when they're lonely, in the days when they're discouraged and ready to give up, oh God, may they see Jesus. And oh God, we want to tell you this morning, we love you. We are dependent upon you, desperate for more of your Spirit in our lives. Do a work, oh God, and help us. Help us to carry you into our world. Pray a blessing upon these people. Courage, minister to each one today. And Lord, we give you the glory and honor and praise in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful day.
My keyboard, I'm like, is something playing on here? Because I have like preset things in there. But it wasn't me.